Having established a few facts about cyclic groups, we can now return to polynomial congruences and really start chapter 4. So in this section, we'll look at linear congruences and power congruences. So the overview of chapter 4 is we want to look at the polynomial congruence f of x congruent to 0 mod m, where f is any polynomial. And the types of questions we'll ask is there a solution? How many solutions are there? And if there are solutions, how do we go about finding the solutions? So in this section, we'll look at linear congruences and dispense with those very quickly. Then we'll focus the remainder of the time on power congruences, x to the k congruent to a mod m, and determine when is a kth power mod m. So we'll come up with Euler's criterion for determining this. And then in particular, we'll look at the case where k is 2 and talk about quadratic residues and non-residues, Euler's criterion for quadratic residues, and then how we go about calculating the square root of a number mod p. Okay. Linear congruences. This will be very brief. So consider the linear congruence AX congruent to B mod M, where A and B are integers. I'll let D be the greatest common factor of A and M. And the claim is this congruence has a solution if and only if D is a divisor of B, in which case there are D distinct solutions mod M. So the proof: AX congruent to B mod M is solvable, is equivalent to saying that AX equals B plus MY for some integers X and Y. That's just definition of congruence. And that's equivalent to AX minus MY equals B for some X and Y and Z. And now we're just down to a linear equation that we want to solve in integers X and Y. And going back to an earlier chapter, we've seen that this has a solution if and only if the GCD of A and M, which is D, divides B, where D is AM. Okay, so that's the first part. And then let's suppose that this condition holds. What is the solution set? So if D divides B, then the solution set of this linear equation, let's call it star, is what? So we have AX minus MY equals B. Keep that in mind. So the solution we said for a linear equation is X is some particular solution plus a multiple of M over D. And y would be a particular solution plus a multiple of a over d. So d is the GCD of a and m. T is any integer, and x0, y0 is a particular solution. All right, so that's the general solution to a non-homogeneous linear equation. We are only interested in the x value here, so this would imply that x equals what? X naught, x naught plus m over d, and we just keep going down until we repeat ourselves mod m. We're trying to find how many distinct values of x are there mod m, and so I'd go down to d minus 1 here, and as soon as you get to the next value, this is just congruent to x naught mod m. So you start repeating yourselves at that point, and we see that there are d distinct values mod m. D distinct solutions x mod m. QED. Okay, on to power congruences. And we've established all the groundwork in the previous section. So I want to come up with a criterion for determining when a value a, when an integer a, is a perfect kth power mod m. So if the equation 1 is solvable, then a is called a kth power residue mod m. Or we just call it a kth power mod m. So if a is congruent to x to the k mod m, it's a kth power. In this section, we're just going to restrict our attention to the case where the group of units is a cyclic group. So for example, m is a prime power, p to the e. And there's no harm in doing that, because if you want to solve x to the k congruent to a mod a product of prime powers, like p1 to the e1, p2 to the e2, and so on, well, that's just equivalent to solving the congruence mod each of the individual prime powers. And then you use the Chinese remainder theorem to solve the general modulus. So there's no harm in restricting our attention to prime power moduli here, where you have a cyclic group. Euler's criterion for kth power residues. Theorem. Suppose that m is a positive integer such that gm is a cyclic group, and that k is any positive integer. Let a be a number relatively prime to m, then the congruence x to the k congruent to a mod m is solvable if and only if a raised to this power is congruent to 1 mod m. And the exponent is the Euler phi function of m divided by the GCD of the Euler phi function in k. If a solution exists, so if a is a kth power, then there are exactly GCD of phi of m and k distinct solutions mod m. So before turning to a proof, let's look at one example. So when is an integer a sixth power mod 25? So x to the sixth congruent to a mod 25. So phi of 25 is 5 squared minus 5, which is 20. So the criterion 2 says that we should have a to the Euler phi function divided by the GCD of the Euler phi function and the exponent k should be congruent to 1 mod 25. And the GCD of 20 and 6 is plainly 2, so this is just a to the 10 power is congruent to 1 mod 25. So if you hand me an integer a, I calculate a to the 10th power and it comes out to be 1, that tells me that a is a perfect 6th power mod 25. Okay, let's look at the proof. So it's going to be an easy consequence of what we did last time. So we proved this theorem last time. If g is a cyclic group, then a is a kth power if and only if a to the n over kn is equal to 1. In which case there are kn distinct solutions. So in our case, g is the group gm, which is a cyclic group by assumption, and the order of g is the Euler phi function. Therefore, by this theorem right here, thus, by the theorem we proved last time, theorem star, let's introduce A. Letting A be an element of GM, so an integer relatively prime to M, we have A is a kth power, so A is congruent to x to the k mod m for some x. If and only if A to this power here, so you take the group order, which is the Euler phi function, you divide by the GCD of the group order in K, and that has to be the identity element in this cyclic group, which means this should be congruent to 1 mod M. And then the second part tells you, so if this is solvable, then by part 2 of the theorem, right here, star star, there are kn, so n again is the Euler phi function, distinct solutions. In our group GM, meaning there are k phi of m distinct integers mod m. And that was the second part. How many distinct values mod m is just asking how many distinct residue classes are there in the group of units. And we're done. So this is just a special result about facts on cyclic groups. So in particular, if we want to look at quadratic residues, you just let k be 2. So if a and m are integers, the integer a is called a quadratic residue mod m if a is a perfect square. So a is congruent to x squared mod m for some integer x. And if no such x exists, then a is called a quadratic non-residue mod m. So for example, what are the quadratic residues mod 13? We want all of the perfect squares mod 13. So perfect squares mod 13. And I'm not going to use a test, I'm just going to enumerate them. So 0 squared, which is 0. 1 squared, 2 squared, 3 squared, 4 squared is 16, which is 16 is congruent to 3. 5 squared is congruent to, that's 25, so negative 1 or 12, let's say. 6 squared is 36. 36 is 26 plus 10. And then notice what happens from this point on. When I go, so this is all mod 13, 7 squared, well 7 is congruent to negative 6. So you would have 7 squared is the same as 10. 8 is congruent to negative 5, so that'll be 12, and so on. So you just repeat these values as you go through the larger residue classes, and so the perfect squares altogether, you have 0, 1, 4, 9, 3, 12, and 10. Euler's criterion, what does it look like for quadratic residues? This looks very simple. So if P is an odd prime, and A is an integer not divisible by P, then A is a quadratic residue mod P if and only if A to the P minus 1 over 2 power is congruent to 1 mod P. And it's just an application of the general Euler criterion. So in this case, the Euler phi function is P minus 1. And since P is an odd prime, P minus 1 is even. And so when you look at the GCD of P minus 1 and 2, this is just equal to 2. So the criterion is A to the, in general, it's phi of m, let's put down the general one, phi of mk congruent to 1 mod m. That just becomes A to the p minus 1 divided by this GCD, which is 2, congruent to 1 mod p. So here m is p. All right, so that's all that's going on there. In particular, when is negative 1 a quadratic residue mod p? So negative 1 is a quadratic residue is equivalent by Euler's criterion to saying that negative 1 to the p minus 1 over 2 is congruent to 1 mod p. Well, negative 1 is a nice value because negative 1 raised to any power is either plus 1 or negative 1. And it'll be a plus 1 precisely when this exponent is even. So p minus 1 over 2 is equal to an even integer, which is equivalent to saying p minus 1 over 2 is 2L for some integer L. And that's equivalent to saying that p is 4L plus 1. So bring the 2 over and add 1 for some integer L, and that's precisely the statement that P is congruent to 1 mod 4. So if P is 1 mod 4, negative 1 is a perfect square, and if P is congruent to 3 mod 4, then negative 1 is not a perfect square. And this turns out to be a really important fact later when we're trying to determine what integers are sums of two squares. There will be two cases to think about, whether P is 1 or 3 mod 4, and it all boils down to this fact. So some questions that remain are these. So Euler's criterion is a test for determining whether a given A is a quadratic residue. So if it is, how do we go about finding its square roots? So if A is a quadratic residue, that means we have an x with x squared equaling A, but how do we go about finding the value x that serves as the square root mod p? And I'll talk briefly about that on the next slide. Another question is, in order to implement Euler's criterion, we have to calculate a very large power. So if you have a big prime, you've got to do this massive calculation, A raised to the p minus 1 over 2 power mod p. And the question is there a more efficient manner of determining whether A is a quadratic residue? And the answer there is yes. We're going to study that in the next chapter. It's called quadratic reciprocity. So I'll return to that in the next chapter. But let me touch briefly on question 1. Calculating square roots. This is going to be a homework problem. Suppose you have a prime that is congruent to 3 mod 4, so of the form 4k plus 3, and that A is a quadratic residue. Then I claim we can solve the equation x squared congruent to A by simply calculating A to the k plus 1 power. And this will be the solution to this equation. And it's just a matter of plugging it in and verifying that it works. Another case we can get square roots really easily is if P is congruent to 5 mod 8, so of the form 8k plus 5. In this case, again, we can write down explicitly what the square roots look like. But notice between these two cases, we have not accounted for every prime. So if P is of the form 4k plus 3, this means it's congruent to 3 or 7 mod 8. And down here it's congruent to 5 mod 8. So we still have this one case where P is congruent to 1 mod 8 left out. And there is no simple known answer for that case. In this case, all we have is some iterative algorithm where you have to go through several loops before you can calculate the square root, and it's called Shank's algorithm. I'm not going to go into that further at this point. It'd be nice to come up with a formula for this special case.